Kaiser. This is preposterous.
Preposterous, is it? Why don't we step outside and settle this like men?
We are outside.
Why don't we step inside and settle this like women?
It's the Zucker Brothers, the Marx Brothers Council Podcast. Hello again, everyone. This is Bob Gassell. As usual, I'm here with Noah Diamond and the late Matthew Conium. How you doing, fellas?
Very well.
I'm Matthew Conium, and I'm very late.
So today we're going to be doing something somewhat different. We're going to be talking about a film that not too many of you have heard about, but in our opinion, well, it's a fact, it's the closest thing you're ever going to see to a modern-day Marx Brothers film, Brain Donors. And the most remarkable thing about this movie is it's actually quite good. It's damn good. Brain Donors was done in 1992 by the creative team responsible for Airplane and the Naked Gun films. Now, I'm guessing many of you are thinking, well, if this film's so good and it was done by these famous guys, why haven't I heard about it? Why isn't it more well-known? And that's a valid question. Hopefully our guest today can shed some light on that. In a little bit, we are going to be joined by producer David Zucker and screenwriter Pat Proft. I'm guessing these guys have run out of things to do during the pandemic, so they're going to be joining us. But before we talk to them, Noah, can you go into a little bit more detail about exactly what Brain Donors is?
I would say that Brain Donors is an attempt, a successful attempt and an admirable attempt to make a new Marx Brothers movie in the early 90s when it was made. It's not a movie that uses the specific characters created by the Marx Brothers, but casts actors in Marx Brothers-like roles. So the three actors who star in it, John Turturro, Mel Smith, and Bob Nelson, they don't impersonate Groucho, Harpo, and Chico, but they are given characters that Groucho, Harpo, and Chico might have played. Mm-hmm. And it is modeled pretty closely in plot and tone on A Night at the Opera and A Day at the Races, too.
Yeah, we should mention that the one who does the Harpo character does talk, but not a whole lot. He's still basically the same character with just a few words here and there.
Yeah, and Mel Smith, who plays the Chico-like role, isn't Italian, but he is British, and so he has a different way of talking than the Groucho, and in this case, talking Harpo characters. I know our listeners often talk about how it's almost impossible to understand British people when they speak.
I have the same problem.
As far as I'm concerned, they did a great job, capturing these characters. They didn't just go for the surface, wisecracks and silly jokes and puns and so forth. They made them wily. They made them smart. This title, Brain Donors, which I'm not fond of, does the film a disservice because it's much more clever than the title lets on. They did the Paramount Marx Brothers, thank God. It's an MGM type plot. It actually is an MGM plot, but that's the Paramount Marxes.
It's a little bit of both, isn't it? The MGM is obviously the story model for it, and yet it feels a little more like the Paramounts in terms of being, it's not a prestige film, like the Thalberg films. It's a knockabout comedy. It also is released by Paramount, incidentally.
I first came across this after it had been in theaters, I think on home videos where I first saw it. And, over the years, I've come across other Marx fans. Some have heard about it, some haven't. And, luckily, in the Marx Brothers Facebook group and other places on the internet, there's a place now where Marx fans could get together and say, yeah, that is pretty good film. I didn't know whether anybody else appreciated it. So we all have a place to love it together. And, I guess the next big question for many out there is like, okay, this sounds good. I'm in. Where do I see this? Well, at the moment, you're not going to see it on Netflix or Hulu. It's on cable. I've seen it on cable occasionally. It's probably been 3 or 4 years since I last saw it. The best place to find it now, you can purchase a DVD, I believe, on Amazon. And some other places. It goes in and out of print, but I think it's on Amazon for about 10, 15 bucks. Or if you're in a big hurry, you could see it right now. If you want to pay one of the places where you can actually download it or pay for a stream, like Amazon Prime or YouTube, I think you're going to pay about 10 bucks. So it is going to cost you 10 bucks to really appreciate this podcast. So I hope we make it worthwhile. Okay, guys, let's do this. Let's bring them in from the Zoom waiting room. Hopefully they're still there.
Hey, let's all hide behind our chairs before we let them in, and they'll think we're not here.
Roast some potatoes in the fireplace.
Okay. We are now honored to welcome two of the gentlemen behind Brain Donors. First, as a writer, director, and producer, he is one of the architects of modern American comedy, who, with his brother Jerry and their friend Jim Abrams, gave us such iconic films as Airplane and the Naked Gun series. His other works include the Kentucky Fried Movie, Ruthless People, Basketball, and my personal favorite, and Matthew's as well, Top Secret. Let's welcome David Zucker.
Hi, shouldn't there be applause now?
That's in post. Also joining us is the screenwriter of Brain Donors, whose career has overlapped with David's on many projects, such as the Scary Movie films, but also includes The Carol Burnett Show, the Police Academy series, Hot Shots, Bachelor Party, and I know this is going to make Noah wet his pants, the Star Wars Holiday Special. Ooh. Here's Pat Proft.
And Naked Gun. Come on, Naked Gun. Why are you holding that back? That's, What's wrong with you?
Yeah.
Point taken. I just didn't want to repeat myself.
But that, it's like Groucho said, you left out a Hunger Dugger and the main one.
And speaking of the Naked Gun, I'm holding something that just came in the mail today. The Blu-ray set for Police Squad, the series, which has recently come out. It's now in high definition. So please pick this up. Okay. So why don't we start way back at the beginning? How did your folks meet each other?
I don't think my folks ever met Pat's folks.
Okay.
But, yeah.
Okay. So why don't we start with how you guys became Marx Brothers fans way back when you were kids. David, you grew up in Milwaukee area and...
Yeah, I grew up in Milwaukee. I remember, I think, you know, probably in the 1950s, I saw You Bet Your Life. And there was this kind of elderly guy who was funny, and that was good. But then it wasn't until college that they had these film societies and they would play, you know, Duck Soup and Night at the Opera, all these Marx Brothers films. And, you know, you had 800 kids in one of these lecture halls and they'd show these films. And it was just, and of course, everybody was stoned and it was wonderful. It just, just laughed as hard as I've ever laughed. So, which is really impressive because here it was, well, you know, from the 30s to the 60s, you know, the stuff lasted. And I mean, of course, it's still funny today.
Were your parents Marx Brothers fans? Did they turn you on to it?
No. They didn't do any humor.
They voted for McCarthy.
Actually, you know, you joke, my dad in the early days, and Jim's mom, yeah, they were supporters of McCarthy. And then they, like, evidently he, you know, he appeared as one thing, like Hitler, you know, he's going to revive the economy. And so, and then quickly it turned south. And they
have you no decency.
Have you no, at long last, Senator, you can run away if you like, Stu. That's just dishonest. Yeah.
So, Pat, what's your story? What's your story with the Marxists?
None of your business. So what the deal is, I remember seeing them very early on. I mean, we used to have Lauren Hardy on TV. We used to have, and I think I caught him on television, You Bet Your Life. I can remember being at my grandmother's house and watching that and thought that, you know, this guy's a funny guy. And then it was a late 50s, early 60s when they started hitting big. It was like Marx Brothers, because I just say it was a college thing. Mm-hmm. And I took my dad to see Night at the Opera. And I don't know whether he thought that was as funny as Lauren Hardy. So I remember that one. But that they're fantastic. It just, there's been nothing like that. So, and it's still funny. Like Dave said, it's still funny. Stuff is still works. Hmm. Except I wouldn't see The Big Store again, I don't think.
Oh, no. They really had some dreadful movies. And
yeah,
nothing was worse than Room Service. Oh, my God. That's the
They thought they would do a somebody else's material. They right. would. That's was the deal. So they took a play it just wasn't it's like Lauren Hardy at 20th Century Fox. You just don't want to ever think about them those films. Those films would be destroyed.
Okay, let's jump ahead to Brain Donors now. You guys have had successes. I'm sure you could write your own ticket to any film you want to do. What made you want to do a Marx Brothers film? What's the genesis of this?
I think it was after The Guns, we were just sitting around. This is how I remember it. We always thought, like, wouldn't it be great if there was a Marx Brothers movie that had just been discovered that nobody knew about, that was like frozen someplace in Alaska under a movie theater up there, permafrost. And then we just started talking about it, and then we just thought, and I had a title, Lame Ducks, which I thought was kind of a cool title. Yeah. It sounded like a Marx Brothers title. And it originally was going to be Flack Pfizer is in Congress, and he's fighting to save this.
Like James Stewart or something. You know,
kind of thing. So he was going to be like, you know, it's still a good idea, by the way. But so that was it. And then I think you've just called Paramount. That's when we could pick up a phone and
that's
say,
right. We could like do it. We want to do a movie. Yeah. our thought process was that we still laughed at the Marx Brothers. I mean, in the mid or late, oh, wait a minute, this was the
90s. 90s.
And it was still funny to us. We'd watch Duck Soup or Night at the Opera or one of their movies or Horse Feathers, and we'd still think this character was still funny. So rather than actually do the Marx Brothers, kind of like the Farrellys had this idea of doing the Three Stooges as the Three Stooges. We didn't want to do that. We wanted to do a, you know, Marx Brothers like trio.
Yeah.
There still could be a three guy, what Pat and I called a three guys comedy.
Right.
And I think we still would like to do a two guys comedy, like a Laurel and Hardy thing.
I'll even do a one guy. It doesn't matter right now.
Yeah. I'm not quite down to that level of desperation, Pat, but yeah. I'm stunned.
I got to say, that is just such a brilliant move. You know, if they had done the actual Marx Brothers characters, everybody would be focused on, you know, does Groucho walk like that? And, you know, is this how Chico actually talks? You know, how good an impression are they doing? But this way, you've sort of dispensed with all that and focused on what's important, you know, the nitty gritty. So it's absolutely the perfect way to do this.
Yeah, it was. The idea was never to do with he's Groucho, he's whatever. I mean, the humor is like that. The humor, but the humor is much like we were doing anyway. I mean, you know, it isn't that far off from that stuff.
Yeah, the dynamic among the characters is kind of, you know, relative to the Marx Brothers.
Why? Here's my thing, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls of the radio, whatever we're on, pod audience. Is what is the why isn't shown? Why haven't we seen it on TV anywhere? Why isn't it hasn't been on any cable service? It hasn't been on any streaming service.
Right.
Do you know why Naked Gun showed up on Turner Classic Movies? Because I wrote a letter.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. God. Yeah. I said.
I didn't know that. You didn't tell me.
No, I should have told you. I said, you know, I wrote a thing saying, you know, Naked Gun, why isn't it on this thing? And they wrote me back and says, why do you think it should be on there? And I said, I wrote it with one of the writers. That's why I think people should see it. But the same thing with Brain Donors. You know, it's got John Turturro's in the thing.
Yeah. I mean, it's so good, too.
Is in the thing. Nancy Marchand. I mean, there's like two people, you know, who people know about from Sopranos and from whatever and whatever. And Mel was a Brit star, but I don't know why it's not around. I don't know.
As I was saying earlier, I think I saw it on cable 4 or 5 years ago, but it's certainly not in a regular rotation anywhere and not on Hulu and Netflix. If you want to pay for a download or a DVD, I guess you could do it that way. But, you know, it's just a shame it's not more well known.
Yeah.
But I know, you know, college age kids, you know, really love the movie. In fact, years ago when my nephews, Ben and Jeremy were at Washington U in St. Louis and Emory in Atlanta. And both of them they showed the movie. They would show one movie every night of the week on their dorm floor. Mm-hmm. And that one week they showed Brain Donors and just loved it every night. That was what they did. I'm sure they were on some kind of substances.
We ran afoul of Paramount, who was making a changeover. I remember that meeting we had.
Oh, yeah.
Because I was already in negotiations to write another one. Did you know that?
I didn't even know that. No, they don't tell me anything. Yeah.
They already said they wanted to do another one. They thought they had something really clicking.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Let's go back to the storyline, you know, of the film. It's obviously Night at the Opera. How did that come to pass?
Well, we bought the rights to Night at the Opera.
That's what they did because it didn't sound like it, I guess.
Right.
I tried to steer away from anything that was in that film. But of course, it's hard not to do that because that's how the Marx Brothers function, that kind of way.
And, right.
You know, if people think it sounds and feels like Night at the Opera, that makes me, I don't care. It makes me happy.
Yeah. I mean, I think the Marx Brothers could have done this. I mean, it's like, Flack Pfizer walks into the ballet and he says to the usher, why these seats are terrible. They're facing the stage. And then another character says to him, you're lying. And Flack Pfizer says, of course I am, but hear me out. You know,
The usher red hands him their tickets, 12 and 11. He says 23, which I like. And there was a line we had, which we had to take out. There was a scene in the beginning where Flack Pfizer is being kicked out of his office. And the guy who rents the room says, look, I haven't seen the pennies. If you haven't, they're little round copper things. I always love that line.
Why did we have to take that out?
I don't know.
I think it's still in there.
I hope it's someplace.
Yeah, I think it's still in.
It'll be like the Feel These Nipples, which is in every movie we've ever done.
That's right. Well, that's a good point. The first time we did You're Excited, Feel These Nipples. It was Flack Pfizer. It was Turturro saying it. And then, so, you know, Brain Donor's bombed. So Pat and I always figured, you know, you can keep using a line until a movie is a hit. And the next time I used it in Basketball, where, Al Michaels says, I've never been so excited in all my life. And Bob Costas says, you're excited. Feel these nipples. And in fact, Costas on the set wanted to say, feel these nipples. And I said, no, it's feel these nipples. You know, it's like, it depends. It's very specific. You can't say it's a different meaning. So he finally, and he argued with me. And I said, we'll do it both ways, you know.
arguing comedy with Bob Costas.
Right, yeah. And so, and anyways. And then so finally, Pat and I, when we wrote, it was, I think, Scary Movie 3 or 4.
Three, I think. Yeah.
Leslie is Ja Rule, you know, uses a shotgun to bust out of a building, shoots his way out of a room.
The face of Mother Teresa, who's on the wall.
Yeah. And so Ja Rule says, this is exciting. And Leslie says, you're excited. Feel these nipples. You know, it's like, and we did it. You know, we finally hit the jackpot.
It's kind of like Hitchcock in all his films. We have that line.
We have that line. Yeah.
So can you tell us how Dennis Dugan got attached to the project as the director? He did a great job.
He directed a movie called Problem Child. Mm-hmm. And I saw it with Jerry, and we thought it was really funny. And so, we called Dennis, and he loved it. Actually, the first one I went to was actually Carl Reiner. Did you know that, Pat?
Oh, no, really?
I had lunch with Carl Reiner because he had done, you know, The Jerk and all these things.
Yeah.
And we thought because he was kind of that era, maybe he could do it. But he said, and I've used this line many times in my career after, he says, I enjoyed reading this script. I would rather see this movie than direct it.
That's a nice way out.
Isn't that a great way out? Yeah. And at the time I bought it, it takes me, I'm not that quick, as you know, but, you know, and so, you know, a week later I thought, hey, that was a line. And then
I wonder if he ever saw it.
I don't know, but he's dead now. So, yeah.
So let's talk about the casting.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Some very interesting choices here. So, you know, John Turturro, I know he really broke through with Barton Fink. Was this before or after Barton Fink?
I don't know.
Obviously, we liked him from something.
So, yeah.
I mean, but I wouldn't.
I think that was inspired, finding him. You know, mm-hmm. I think he was so good.
You know, it's like he's never done anything like this ever again, has
he? Yeah. Not before, not since.
He should do comedy. I mean, he should do.
Yeah.
What is that? I thought he was so great in that the Redford movie about the game show.
Quiz show.
I love that. I loved him in that. I mean, that was Flack Pfizer. Flack Pfizer. When you get down to it, yeah. I mean, he had that same kind of craziness going, which was. Did he come in, or did you call him in, or?
I remember I had a meeting with him. I think I had lunch with him. And we talked about it, and he thought the script was funny. And so, you know, he signed on.
That's nice. Yeah. Jason Alexander at one point was the thought. In fact, I ran into him Alexander, and he was still pretty adamant the fact that he would have been better. Which I thought was
kidding. Really?
Yeah. I ran into him. Yeah. And I said, hey, Jason. He said, you know what? I would have been so, you know, you went on about it. And I just, so that was like a really grueling 2 minutes. All it was. Well, nice to see you. Thank you.
He could have been good. I mean,
he would have been good.
Yeah, he would have been good.
On the internet, I read, you could tell me whether this is true or not, that Alec Baldwin was considered. Is that it?
No, I don't remember that.
I don't remember that either.
Okay. I don't remember that.
That's, you know, that's probably from QAnon.
Yeah, right, IMDb. Yeah. They're very similar.
Yeah, but you know, a lot of these guys are really fine actors. You know, there's fine actors like Alec Baldwin, I think, is great. And well, Liam Neeson is great. But whether they be funny is, you know, that's questionable. Because they don't remember, you know, a guy like Leslie Nielsen was a B actor and Stack, Bridges, Graves, and who right. we used. And so they're not always the ones who are funny.
You don't want a guy who's, you know, in his acting is going, hey, I'm being funny. You don't want that. Right. That's why when Hot Shots, when we signed Charlie Sheen, the first day on the set, he says, how do I do this?
Oh, really?
And so I said, I want you to go for an Oscar. I want you to shoot. Yeah. I want you to go for an Oscar.
Totally. Do it seriously. Yeah.
Yeah. Just, you know, this is Citizen Kane. You vote for it.
I think guys like Dustin Hoffman or Al Pacino, they're like off the charts great actors. But I think I don't think they would be as good at this kind of comedy, because it just really means.
Yeah.
You know, subsuming, is that a word? Your character.
Word.
Oh, I know. God. You could learn from me, Pat. Yeah.
You got to use that, though.
Yeah. Along with, I'd rather see this movie than direct it. You may use that too.
That's actually a great title for a movie. I'd rather
see this movie
than be in it.
which is most of our movies, yes.
But how do we get this past Mrs. Oglethorpe?
Relax. After she sees Alan dance, you've got nothing to worry about. Except for taxes, depletion of the ozone layer, and diseases due to any sexual contact.
Mel Smith was quite a find, too. And as Matthew has told us, he's apparently quite big over in the UK.
Yeah.
How did you find him?
Yeah, I loved Mel. I went over to... I had been watching Smith and Jones and all those shows from Britain, the French and Saunders. I mean, I just loved this. And then for Hot Shots, we had an opening at the Prince's something or other. I don't know. It was a big deal. So we showed it there. And I made sure that I met Mel, and I met French and Saunders, and I met I liked Mel a lot. I thought how he looked, and I thought he was very funny, and I thought he could, you know, rattle off the right. I hope I brought his name up. I don't remember if I did. I hope I did. But he
did you meet? Didn't you meet the Prince and Charles and Diana?
I met, that was when I met. Yeah, I met
That's
Diana
so cool.
and yeah, and Charles.
They weren't interested in being in the film.
I asked them. Naked Gun.
Yeah,
was the Queen upset?
Yeah. Hey, what did he say?
He said no, and he did the cuff thing. No.
Oh, really? But he knew about it.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
I heard somewhere that, you know, Prince Philip had loved Airplane, but I didn't hear.
I don't know. Hot Shots, what was fun, they sat behind me. And
really?
She laughed at the sex jokes, and he laughed at the at the Air Force-y kind of military joke. So it was like there was no compatibility. That was funny.
Yeah.
But that's, but I still, I'm so sad Mel, you know, he's passed on.
Yeah.
He did such a great job with this character. You did too, Pat, because it's easy for people to just write Chico as like a guy who makes silly puns and, you know, is quite a dope. But, you know, like I've been trying to say here, you made him wily. And that's really the key to the Chico character. Yeah. And he's charming, as always. And, you know, I just felt like I was watching a Chico relative from the UK. Yeah.
What you don't want to do is make a Larry Fine. You don't want to. Right. You don't want to make that. Yeah, that kind of thing. But you know, I was very pleased that there was funny things for him to do, and he was very good. And yeah, there were so many good people in London at the when I went there, because Rowan Atkinson, nobody knew about Mr. Bean. I brought up my idea was to go Fox, send me to London, And I'll bring back some funny people and make movies with these, like French and Saunders and stuff. And nobody knew about Bean. And then I pitched to Fox about we should do Bean. I mean, we should do that movie. And they didn't see it. And in fact, there was a Bean short was in front of Hot Shots.
Oh.
But not here. It was in every other country but United States. There was a
used to show shorts.
Yeah, they had a short before, which was very interesting. Yeah. Anyway.
How'd you find Bob Nelson?
I really don't know. It was obviously whoever casted this did a damn good job with finding the right people. I mean, I was at the Comedy Store in the very beginning of the Comedy Store. So I may have run into that when I I may have run into him at that point or whatever it was, but
I can't remember how the casting, you know, the details, but I imagine Dennis would have sent us clips.
I think Dennis had a lot to do with this because you couldn't have had a better guy. I mean, this person was there. You know, it's like this kind of Marx Brothers humor, there's people who can do it. And it's just not being done. That's the ridiculous part of this, is that a whole swath of funny is not
people still laugh at that kind of humor. Yeah. But I think I remember seeing Bob Nelson doing his, you know, the routine with the scars. He would have these floating scars
and juggle them.
And I was sold. I said, it's not Harpo exactly, but we didn't want Harpo exactly.
They may have sent tapes around because that's what probably happened. Yeah, his Jiffy Jeff thing has always made me laugh because I remember he did one of those Rodney Dangerfield hello young comedy things. I think I saw that.
Yeah.
Now many hardcore Marx fans, and I know several of them, are going to be asking, why isn't there a Zeppo character in this film?
Well, you know, wasn't it Chico that says we're twice as funny without Zeppo?
But the Zeppo guy, now I'm sorry, but I don't remember who played that. But the guy who fell in love with the girl, with Lisa LeBaron, that was Zeppo, basically. That would have been Zeppo. He was always he wasn't even the love interest, was he? He just would show up and then never see.
Yeah, Zeppo was often the love interest. I mean, you're talking about the real Zeppo, but they figured they didn't need him.
When the clock on the wall strikes 10, and me saying that, I know. When the clock on the wall,
Zeppo was said to be very funny off screen. He was just a little stiff on screen.
Wonder what he did. I would love to have seen Marx Brothers, you know, on stage, and what he did. I wonder if he did any more than what he did in the film.
I can't imagine it was anything more. He was just a straight man, but he happened to be their brother. So, you know,
But then he became one of the greatest
agents or something. He became an agent. But he was.
But he'd rather represent the movie than see it.
That's right. Yeah. He was. I think he fared a lot better than Gummo, who was offered up to the military, I guess, by Minnie. Yeah.
For experimentation.
Yeah, for experimentation. That was his fate. Yeah.
Now let's talk about Nancy Marchand for a minute. You know, she really holds this film together in this Margaret Dumont type role. She does physical gags. She has the great expressions. You know, I can't imagine you finding anybody better. She was spectacular.
I had three movies shooting, which was so weird. It was just so weird. So I would drop in occasionally on the set, and she was just so fun to talk to. I mean, she had stories about David Susskind, people that we didn't even think about. She really was terrific. God, she was wonderful.
And what I learned from that is that there's some humans who can do comedy and some who can't. And before that, I thought, well, you just get a straight person and they're automatically good, you know, like Leslie was or Lloyd Bridges. But what happened was that we, on a subsequent Naked Gun, we had another lady who had that part, the Margaret Dumont part, to Drebin. Mm-hmm. And she couldn't do it. It was very difficult. I had to grind it out. Mm-hmm. And it was... Nancy Marchand could just do it. She just, you know, she had
just locked into it. And yeah. I think you have to also have a great fun about yourself. I mean, it's like, yeah. it's like, you know, she was, it wasn't Nancy Marchand. It was all of a sudden she was somebody else.
Yeah. And she knew where the joke was.
Yeah.
But didn't try to ham it up. Never tried to ham it up. She was always she was always Mrs. Pinchon from from Lou Grant.
Lou Grant.
That was mainly where I had my radar of her was Lou Grant. Mm-hmm.
But she also was great in Naked Gun. I mean, that whole sequence she did when he's urinating and she's listening to it and stuff.
Yes, like yeah. Like, well, she was the mayor. She was the mayor.
The mayor. Yeah. Yeah.
Which pretty much she played the same character.
Yeah.
That was, yeah, Mrs. Pinchon.
Write the same stuff.
Yes.
Right. Okay,
But Ed Asner is not funny. Right. Okay, go on. Yes.
Okay, let's jump ahead in the timeline here. After the film was shot and while it was in post-production, from what I could gather, David, you and your brother left Paramount before the film was finished, before it was released. What can you tell us about that?
I think that Stanley Jaffe took over. Who was the guy who was there? There was a guy
Tartikoff,
who was the
Tartikoff came in. Tartikoff was there, I think, or came in, whatever it was. Oh, he came in. So there was it was Paramount was regime was changing.
The regime changed.
And they you know, like I say, they already had me running a second one. So they were happy.
Yeah.
But the new guys didn't seem to take to it. And
you guys
and,
didn't
and,
get it. And, Jaffe who took Jaffe?
I don't remember. I remember that we had screenings and they were trying to, I don't know what they're doing, trying to find an audience for it, which I thought was very strange because I thought we had one.
I remember Jerry and I having a meeting with Barry.
I was there.
Barry, yeah, okay.
The yelling one? The yelling meeting? There was a Hollywood yelling meeting, which I had never been in before. We were in some kind of a conference room. I remember
Barry London.
Yeah.
That's what I'm trying to think of.
Because we said, our deal was, why isn't there a publicity for this movie?
Yeah, there was no publicity.
And he said, but there is. And then there was... I remember, I think London whispered in Tartikoff's ear, and Jerry said, "What are you saying?"
Oh yeah.
And then he said, "None of your business. What do you mean?" Anyway, it was like, da, 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 da. And the guy was London was going through he ran out, came back in with a bunch of paper that had the money he spent on publicity for the thing. And then I'm sitting there like a dork. I mean, you guys are leaving, so this is like I'm out of the studio.
Did we get up and leave? Did we get up and leave?
Jeez. So it ended up with nothing really. You know, it was one of those meetings you have when you know within 2 minutes. Oh fuck!
Right? No. Once you're in a meeting, it's gone. It's you know, forget it. It's like, oh, we'll have a meeting with you creepy people. And we'll,
It's pretty much it then.
And it's the guy who sets up the meeting who's the traitor.
He was always a smart one.
Yeah, he was always a smart one. Yeah. He was a smart one.
But this all adds into my why isn't this shown? I don't understand it. There's a 75-minute comedy which is not shown anywhere. I mean,
You're talking about the publicity, and I want to touch upon that. I mean, I go back and I look at the commercials and the trailers and the print ads, and they don't really do the film justice. And they change the title on you, right?
I thought Lame Ducks was a whole better.
Right. I mean, Brain Donors implies that these guys are morons or something, and they're not.
When it played in Century City in L.A., they spelled Brain Donor wrong.
E-R?
Yeah, because I have a picture with Karen outside with Tartikoff. I mean, maybe that's funny. I don't know. But it was like they spelt it wrong.
That would have been a better title. Yeah.
I don't remember any publicity for it. I don't remember ever being...
No, there was a poster. We didn't like the posters very much.
Nothing. It seemed like it would have done great overseas. I mean, it is like a thing that is very visual and silly. I mean, and physical comedy. And I don't know why... I don't know why they didn't take it to this plate in Japan for a while. Let's see who goes there. Let's go in Germany. Yeah. See what's happening there.
It was so surprising because usually studio people are really smart.
says David.
Well, let me ask you about the claymation segments that bookend this film. How did that come to be?
I think Jerry had something to do with that. He found this guy who did it. And
Alan Ray, the guy was from Oregon or Portland or something like that.
Will Vinton, I think, who did the California Raisins and the Domino's Pizza Noid commercials.
But I think Jerry was in charge of that.
Part of the thing was there was a discussion that the film came in at like about 72 minutes or something, so 74 minutes, and to add some other stuff to make it.
Oh, we need to add Hamburger Helper. Yeah.
And why we cut the damn movie down, I don't understand either. I mean,
probably because a lot of it didn't get laughs. But,
well, I don't know.
Yeah.
Everybody laughed at the penny thing.
And that was him. Yeah.
I wish I could find the script. I wish I could find the original script, because the original script was
or the cut scenes. You know, in those days they would just throw out cut stuff. They didn't know from
it, and then you throw it away. Yeah.
Yeah.
Pat, you talk about a sequel that you were starting to piece together. Do you recall what the premise of that might have been?
I think the premise was I'm going to put it back in Congress.
Okay. Where it should have been. Yeah. Right, yeah.
I'll show you bastards.
It would have been great. Yeah.
You are.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I think there was something like that. I still think of, you know, there's still ideas you get that you would think like, my God, this was another one of those kinds of comedies, which would be fun to do. I, you know, yeah. I'm sad now.
I know. This has kind of been a bummer. Yeah.
Yeah, I know. You know.
Should they maybe not put this podcast out?
My wife was murdered last night, so I have, you know, I'm a little down.
Oh, I was meaning to email you about that. I'm sorry.
Yeah, yeah. No, they're here. I got yellow tape all around.
It's a testament to Prof that he can still bounce back.
I just saw the cops wear a mask when they're in the house. That's all I care about. Right.
You know the great Valare?
I knew him back when he was known as a pretty good Valare. We served in the army together. He owes me one. I threw myself on top of an 18-year-old Vietnamese girl and saved his life.
It must have been very difficult for John not to give these lines a Groucho spin, because so many of them you could just hear in your head sounding like something Groucho would say. I'd like to ask him. I'd love to have him here to how much I appreciated his performance, but I'd like to ask him if he ever had to steer himself away from acting like Groucho.
He probably had even more energy than the Groucho character had, I think, too. I think it was kind of hyped a little bit.
Caffeinated, yeah.
That's right. You know, he had the rhythm of Groucho, but he didn't need to imitate the voice.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I wish there was a second one. I wish there was.
I know.
I wonder if this he shied away from comedy after this. Maybe I'm going with the cones.
Yeah. I'm going. And he did. There. He did. Yeah, right. Yeah. Rather than Proft and Zucker. What was I thinking? Yeah.
My God.
It's a lost masterpiece.
And similarly with Mel Smith, of course, he obviously doesn't sound anything like Chico, but he has got a different accent to the other people.
So he is
a kind of immigrant character.
Yeah.
My involvement with the film is that it was a kind of a film that I always wished existed before I realized that it actually did. I always used to say that it would be a good exercise to mount stage productions of Animal Crackers and Coconuts again, but cast actors who had never seen the Marx Brothers and just see what they do with the material. And that's kind of what we've got here.
I always thought would be a good idea would be to write an original stage production, which would be an amalgam of the best of the Marx Brothers, taking from Duck Soup, Night at the Opera, Horse Feather, everything, the best lines, make a new plot. And then do a stage play. I think they there has been. Oh, they did Minnie's Boys, I guess, but that wasn't.
Yeah. But the thing, if that happened, the thing to do is not have a guy with the mustache and the thing and the cigar. And I think you have to do it kind of like we did in Brain Donors. I think
original characters. Yeah,
I don't think that would.
But it would be a good stage show, probably a good musical too.
It would be great somehow that this. I remember we had the first read through of this thing. I remember the room was like rocking with laughter. I mean, it was amazing, and it, like, you know, people hadn't heard the words before.
Yeah, and
really.
You know, Animal Crackers had a great plot for something like this, for a stage musical.
Mm-hmm.
Coconuts and Animal Crackers, I think, were the first two that they that they did as stage plays, and then they filmed it on, you know, in Astoria Studios.
By the way, their body work was so cool.
I mean, there was a definite curve of, you know, they did Animal Crackers, Monkey Business, Horse Feathers, and then Duck Soup was very much like, you know, I would always compare it to Top Secret, which was our funniest movie, but it didn't work as a movie because we had no character plot. There was a structure to it, but we didn't obey the movie rules of three act and character arc. So in the end, there could be no ending anyway. But oddly enough, we did it in reverse. We did our Night at the Opera first, which was Airplane. Mm-hmm. And then Top Secret was Duck Soup. Just a collection, just one gag after another.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And very possibly, you know, Duck Soup was their funniest movie. I mean, there's nothing like that mirror scene. And when Harpo tries to take a hammer to that clock to make it stop. I mean, just some really wild stuff.
That's funny, because I was thinking the thing I like is Louis Calhoun when he like, oh, I'm exasperated. And then Harpo cuts the hair
cutting the hair, the tops of the things as they march by.
It's Saturday, like, nobody show up.
Yeah. Saturday was a doubleheader, nobody show up.
They play these every so often. They'll play them, and I'm in Minnesota. There's a place I grew up called Columbia Heights, which has the Heights Theater, which is a great Art Deco place.
Oh.
And they'll play Marx Brothers every so often, and it'll just be packed.
And that's how they should be seen, with an audience of other people.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We were going to play Brain Donors there. I don't know what happened. I was going to four-wall the theater and put it in there and just to have people see it.
Yeah. And because you're lonely.
Yeah, I'm very lonely. Yeah, and my wife's been murdered. So I, what am I
doing? That's right.
Time on your hands.
It's so great of you to
there
do this.
There will be a
today.
Funeral. I like to time it.
Well, yeah, after this podcast.
It's good to hear you guys have so much fondness for this film because, you know, it came and it went. And, you know, I sometimes wonder, did the makers of this film abandon it? Did they, you know, dismiss it as a failure? But I'm glad to hear that you guys have so much fondness for it. Yeah.
No, I watch it. I'm still surprised. Like, hey, this is funny.
I know.
So good. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. My wife and I watched it the other night, and I don't recall the last time she laughed out loud. She absolutely loved it.
I know. That makes me sick because it should be seen by more people.
Yeah.
Particularly the dressing room sequence when the lobster gram comes in. She was just rolling on the floor.
Yeah.
Yeah. 3 minutes, Mr. Jules. I like that.
That's great. And again, Dennis Dugan does a great job keeping this thing moving because it's just not a wasted frame, not a wasted gag. And they're all executed so well.
Yeah.
An incredible pace and incredible rapidity of jokes. I mean, originally I was going to say, you know, it's as good as a Marx Brothers script, but actually, you know, it's better than a good half a dozen of the Marx Brothers scripts. I mean, there are plenty of Marx Brothers films that, you know, could do with being as funny as that script. It really is a very, very fine job of recreation.
That's nice. That's nice to hear.
Well, the pace really came out of when Pat and I did the Kentucky Fried Theater back in the 70s. You know, I think we never wanted to be up there on stage when people weren't laughing. And we found that it was easier to keep people laughing, you know, than to start them all up again. And so that, you know, people always ask us, you know, the pace of Hot Shots or Airplane. And this is really came out of Kentucky Fried Theater.
Yeah. It's being on stage. It was like, you know, when you do Kentucky Fried Theater, the thing was it's end on a laugh. It doesn't have to have an ending. Just and a laugh.
Yeah, and see, yes.
Yeah. Dugan did a good job with that. I mean, he did keep things moving along. Were you there, David, most of the days or was
No, I wasn't. Yeah. Because I think I was doing one of the other movies. I was doing one of the Naked Guns.
The thing also was what was there was there. There was nothing that was changed, which I was very happy with. I mean, every word that was written.
Oh, yeah. Dugan was very faithful to the script.
They didn't add stuff. They didn't think, hey, that could be funnier if.
Yeah.
And I thought that was very nice because I usually would get, you know, whatever we do, we get calls or I'm on the set and saying, you know, is this funny? That's always my favorite thing to hear. That's always pleasant. I, you know, it's like Bachelor Party. I wrote with Neil Israel. All of a sudden, Neil Israel is the director, and he turns to me once and he says, "You think that's funny? You wrote it with me."
As if this isn't working, it must have been you.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So, I ended a lot of those arguments.
Yeah.
David, you had mentioned to me while we were prepping that you were putting together a book and there was some Marx-related story.
Yes, I just finished a book that's going to be published on Amazon Kindle, that thing, in a few weeks. And it's kind of my family history, but done, you know, kind of humorously.
Yeah.
You know, it's basically a transcript of an interview that I did with my grandmother. So she tells her story about how she immigrated here from Hungary and everything. Anyway, she comes to Milwaukee, and in her first date with my grandfather was at a vaudeville theater in Milwaukee. Oh, and I stretched things a little bit, and I said it could have been the Marx Brothers, you know. So, and thank God for the internet, you know. I found an old picture of the Majestic Theater. It was which was a vaudeville theater on Wisconsin Avenue, and I put that in. So I mentioned the Marx Brothers, and also Dorothy Parker at the end. Huh. When she said, I mean, because my grandmother died, you know, so in 1985. And so I told the story about how Dorothy Parker was in Hollywood writing for Sam Goldwyn, and it was some routine biopic. And she turns the script in, and on Monday, Goldwyn, you know, comes storming into the office saying, "Dorothy, I need happy endings. This movie needs a happy ending." And it was a biography, and Dorothy Parker says, "Sam, in all of recorded human history, out of billions of years, no one's life ever had a happy ending." People just die laughing when I tell them that.
You should have put "feel these nipples" at the end of it.
Oh, yeah. Sam, feel these nipples.
You want a happy ending. Feel these nipples.
You know, on Amazon Kindle, you can still change things. So I'll put that in there. No, it's a more of a heartfelt kind of thing.
That's nice. No, it's nice.
It's sweet. Yeah.
You sent me some of the stuff, and I really liked it.
I'm also doing the story of ZAZ from the time we were started Kentucky Fried Theater in 71 in Madison to the opening of Airplane in 1980. So, and that's a cool story, and also a lot of pictures.
And that could be a little movie, in fact.
Yeah. Yeah. And Proft is in that, of course. And, yeah. Yeah.
And John Turturro, for some reason.
Yeah, he was a major part of it until I cut him out.
He never writes. He never says anything. On his like movies, it's never listed even.
Yeah,
have you ever looked at his IMBD or thing, or whatever it is? I don't think it's even listed.
Yeah. Yeah, well.
By the way, this is a piece of irrelevant trivia, but I'll mention it anyway.
Oh, great.
While I was doing research for this episode, I came across the fact that Pat's wife, Karen Phillip, appears in every single episode of MASH.
Yeah, she was in the first three or four episodes, and they discovered that you know, all the characters shouldn't have a girlfriend. I mean, that's obviously was, you know, that's didn't work.
And the reason Karen's in every episode is because a shot of her from the pilot, her and Hawkeye and the medical team running towards one of the choppers, is used in the opening credits of every episode for the entire series. I think I'll put up on our blog page a still of the frame so you could pick her out.
Is she recognizable in that shot?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
We make millions of dollars a day.
Yeah, every time that's shown. Yeah,
that's why I'm missing her. I'm really going to miss her.
I know, because they stop the payments as soon as...
Yeah, is she dead?
Is she dead yet? That's all they want to know.
No, but that was this, because she was in Brazil 66. She sang for a long time. That's what she did. She was in a group for many, many years. And then she turned to that stuff, so...
I just wanted to make one point. We were talking about some of the great lines in it. And just one that I wanted to personally thank you for.
"Dear Lillian, soon I hope to take you on a Caribbean cruise where we can hold hands on a soft summer's evening and watch that old Jamaican moon. Why that old Jamaican will be mooning us, I have no idea."
Oh. Which is, I think, as as close to shot an elephant in my pajamas as anyone since has ever got.
I used to do that in my act.
At the Comedy Store.
My act is in movies now.
Yeah.
I love that line.
And also every performance of Kentucky Fried Theater, you did that. It was at a thing called Lawrence Lips.
Yeah, Lawrence Lips. I was a Vietnamese vet, and it was just such a stupid thing to say.
You said I fought in that war, the big V, Korea. Very Marx Brothers. Yeah.
So what are Noah and Matthew? What are you just plugged in to ask questions? Is that what this is?
Well, we take turns hosting these episodes.
I'm just wondering who the, I don't know.
And this is Bob. Bob's,
they're my lawyers.
Yeah. I thought we had the smallest audience in the history of the world.
Oh, this is the audience.
Oh, no. Dozens of people are going to hear this.
I was really depressed.
So I should say the name of my book is Before the Invention of Smiling, because I have all these pictures of my relatives and they're very dour. Nobody smiled then. But
flowers can be sent to my murdered wife's thing. That
okay, you want to give that address? Because no, I certainly don't need the money.
So yeah, we're going to push everybody to who's listening here, obviously, to get the film one way or another. So hopefully
that's right. Yeah,
yeah. Find it. Will help. I see it every so often on Amazon. It is. Sometimes they bunch them with other movies too, which
goes in and out of print.
So we're still waiting for the Blu-ray or that was the Blu-ray.
He got it. There is a Blu-ray. Huh?
No, that was a police squad.
Police squad.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
We'll await the Blu-ray of Brain Donors.
Because we get it every slide. Karen sends out for our movies so we can give them to people.
When she was alive, yeah.
Yeah, when
that's sweet.
That's one of the sad things. I got to find out. Right.
It always reminds you of her. It's like when we talk about sending out for these things. Very, very sweet.
But I see it on occasion. That's too bad.
Yeah, I know. It's so sad.
It's so sad. I don't know why it didn't play around the world. I have no idea.
I was talking about Karen's death.
I'm past that. I'm moving on.
Fuck brain donors.
I can't dwell. I haven't had a vaccine shot yet.
Right. That's what you're looking forward to. You know, I can introduce you to some young chicks.
That's the thing. That's the as soon as COVID's over.
Yes. And she's going to bring a friend the next time, too.
See, that'd be another thing. The Marx Brothers characters in this time with the COVID and the thing.
Another hospital scene.
Yeah, they have a clinic.
You know, the washing of the hands in Day at the Races, they sing down by the old mill stream and they wash their hands 100 times.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, earlier last year, when washing your hands constantly became all the rage, that was an oft referenced bit.
Make a good meme. Yes.
Even in Brain Donors, in the doctor scene, you know, the surgical masks, that feels very current all of a sudden.
See, we had the mask with the face on it before they're selling billions of them.
I know.
We could be so rich.
Also in the examination scene in Day at the Races, Harpo and Chico, the backs of their lab coats say Joe's service station on them. There's a gag like that in Airplane, the STP.
STP, that's right, on the back of the jumpsuit. Yeah.
And in fact, in Wrongfully Accused, it's HEMAC Meat Company in the back of the...
HEMAC again.
Now, I like HEMAC.
That's been a character whenever Pat, you know, we write these scripts together, we bounce them back and forth, and Pat often names the characters. I don't care. So one of them's HEMAC in one of our scripts.
I grew up with Jim HEMAC, so that was
Jim HEMAC, okay. But it's always a woman in our script.
It's a woman. I made it a woman so he could assume.
Okay. It wasn't that good of a friend, yes.
You know, I wanted to tell you guys that I appreciate the film even more now than when I first saw it. And I loved it back then. It really rewards Marx fans for repeated viewings.
Did you see it when it came out?
I honestly don't recall it in theaters when it first came out. I think a couple of years later, somebody I worked with said, "Hey, you're a Marx Brothers fan. You might like this film." So when I was at Blockbuster, I picked it up on VHS.
Yeah, isn't that great?
And I heard about it from Mr. Cassell. Yeah, he said there's this film that's like, you know, from the airplane guys, mm-hmm. and it's like the Marx Brothers, and I'd never heard of it. So I got a secondhand copy of the VHS, and I thought, my God, how did I not know about this film?
Most of America, yes.
I came across it on television, I think it came out in 92, no later than 94. I was in high school and I was at the peak of my Marx Brothers obsession and came across it on television in progress and sort of gradually caught on, like, oh, this is very much like a Marx Brothers movie. I was fascinated by it and I eventually figured out what it was and where it had come from. And, you know, at the time, the Marx Brothers and Woody Allen were my two favorite things. I would spend all night rewatching those sets of movies. And in the same way that When Harry Met Sally felt like a Woody Allen movie without Woody Allen, Brain Donors was the Marx Brothers equivalent. It's kind of another one you didn't know about.
Well, when people would ask Jerry and Jim and me, you know, what was our main influences, you know, we would always say Woody Allen and the Marx Brothers.
Yeah, there's a real affinity there between them, and early Woody Allen movies owed something
great.
To
them. I mean, the, you know, Bananas is like crazy.
In our Kentucky Fried Theater show, we did a sketch. It was called The Courtroom, and it was very Marx Brothers. And this was back in 1974 or 5. But I remember a friend of mine, Rich Markey, came from Milwaukee to move here, and he's another Marx Brothers fan like I am. So one of the first things we did was we looked up Groucho's address and drove up to Truesdale and knocked on the door, and Groucho's nurse answered, and you know, she's very nice, but said he wasn't up to seeing anyone that day. And unfortunately, I never tried again. I should have now when I think about it, I should have gone back every day.
I know.
And we didn't have cameras in those days, or we didn't carry them around. You know, everybody has a camera on them at all times. People don't remember the era before cell phones. Yeah. And so I doubt if we even would have brought a camera.
I would have sketched. I sketched everything.
You sketched like you.
That's why I carried that easel. Why are you carrying an easel? You always said to me.
It was before cell phones. Yeah.
Because I think like that, I met, I was big Lauren Hardy, still am. And as, on my birthday once, which I thought was kind of cool, they took me to visit the graves of Stan and Ollie, which I thought was, you know, was kind of sweet. And it was like, you know, I'm standing there, I'm thinking, oh my God, it's the closest I've ever been to these guys. But it was a nice feeling. And then afterwards, I was taken to Hal Roach's house, which was, and the same thing happened. He was supposed to meet me and his maid, Spanish maid, came out and I know nothing. She was doing this to me. I know nothing. And I'm going, oh, come on. You know? So I had these things. I found in a flea market, I found stationery from the Hal Roach Studios, 1935. And it had these great characters of all the characters up there. And I said, well, he signed this. And he did, but he signed it in the bottom like it was a letter. So I never get to meet him, but I just stood outside the door.
You got that close. Yeah.
He was 100. He was 90 something or something. Like that.
And, you know, and when I went and knocked on the Groucho's door, what I wanted to do was I had tickets to our show. I wanted to give him tickets to the show. So my fantasy was Groucho coming to the show and seeing us do the courtroom because we were doing vaudeville.
What was the woman who actually was with him in the last part of his life?
Oh, yeah. Aaron Fleming. Mm-hmm. And Andy has a lot to say about that. And he knows what really happened. Mm-hmm. I don't know if he went into that on. Yeah.
Was it a good thing or a bad thing that she was there?
Both.
I think it was both.
It was. It kind of put him out there. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
So on that note, we want to thank you both for joining us. It really was a tremendous honor to have you on talking about this film and hearing your enthusiasm for it. And we're going to do what we can to get this film seen by as many people as possible. Maybe even get that sequel into production.
Oh, yeah. We're working on it.
Nice meeting you guys. You guys are pretty
nice meeting you.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
So how about that? That was David Zucker and Pat Proft.
I thought they'd never leave.
And I got to say, I am so proud of you guys. I'm proud of all of us, actually. We talked for almost an hour there and not one Shirley joke. Okay. I didn't think we could do it, but we did it.
Yeah. I figure they've heard it before.
And I got to say, the most fascinating thing I got out of this interview was the fact that while they were making it and soon after, the studio was actually quite high on it, wanted to do a sequel. But the new blood that came in just basically just shelved it. Reminds me of that film, The Big Picture. I don't know if anybody else saw it. You'll know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I thought that was just, I thought it perplexed people from day one. That was very interesting, yeah.
I got to say, this promotional campaign, this sucked. These posters, this artwork, there's nothing about this that hints that it has anything to do with the Marx Brothers. I mean, anything.
The tagline is, in the tradition of Abbott and Costello, the Three Stooges, and the Reagan administration.
Yeah.
Like,
well, there you had an opportunity to alert Marx
Talk
Brothers
about
fans.
For God's sake. Two other comedy teams who are not evoked at all.
Yeah, and the artwork also, and as well as the title, strongly suggests that it's a medical comedy, which is only one scene in it.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that tagline, yeah. But also that awful music, the awful theme music, which I believe is a casualty of it being dumped, isn't it?
I get what you're saying, but the guy who did the theme, Ira Newborn, and I know his work. He did the great theme for the Naked Gun Police Squad, and also did music for SCTV. Did the theme for SCTV. He's done some great work. I think maybe it's just the arrangement here. It just seems sort of maybe a little too synthesized for our tastes.
Yeah.
A lot of the choices in the film, it seems like, you know, they're very deliberate about not making it a period piece, you know? So you're not going to use music that sounds like the 30s or cinematography that looks like the 30s. Yeah. So they kept it contemporary, but that now plays a little bit like, you know, late 80s television values.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Would have been interesting, wouldn't it, if we had gotten a series of films with these characters and if Turturro and Nelson and Smith had, in essence, become a comedy team.
But I really wonder whether Turturro, after he had hit it big, would have even considered coming back to do this again.
It does capture him right at the moment of his breakthrough. I think it's the year after Barton Fink, and maybe
it came out after Barton Fink, but it had been in the can for a while, so I wonder if it had been shot actually before.
Yeah, it's interesting because of Turturro and who he went on to become, you know, the film features this starring performance from a very idiosyncratic but very good and highly respected actor.
I can't wait to see him at Carnegie Hall.
I wonder if when Raising Eyebrows finally gets made, if he would consider reprising that characterization?
Yeah, that's a thought.
As the elder Rowan, what's his character?
Flackfizer.
Yeah.
Yes,
Flackfizer.
Raised up my ears inside Flackfizer's house. Well, one of the things that works so nicely about his performance is that he conjures up the spirit of Groucho very convincingly without ever sounding like him. I mean, he has a very different, I know he probably could do a reasonable Groucho voice if he chose to, but he has more of a Mel Brooks kind of raspy burr to his voice, and it makes it, you know, he can never be accused of doing a direct impersonation, but he can go right up to the line of behaving like Groucho, but more so than somebody with a similar voice could.
Mrs. Oglethorpe, you look wonderful. I could make love to you right here and now.
Roland, please, let's keep this on a professional level.
Very well, then I'll charge you $50 a pop.
Huh?
At one point, he calls someone a contemptible cur. I think that's a direct quote. And there also is an interesting moment when he says to Nancy Marchand's Margaret Dumont-like character, he says, you make me feel like a natural woman, which is exactly what Groucho would do. It's just that it's a contemporary song for the time the movie was made, sliding into popular song lyrics and conversation.
Very impressive. And that's the key to the whole film, isn't it? That's how the whole film works. And that's what's so admirable about it, I think. You know, we're used to seeing, as we said in the discussion, sort of new Laurel and Hardy films and new Three Stooges films, where you get some impersonators who might be quite good, you know, in some cases are pretty good, and you know, some fairly dodgy material that hasn't been had much thought put into it. And this is the other way around. You know, it's a completely reimagined and yet authentic version of a Marx Brothers film that never was. And one of the things that Pat said that I thought was quite interesting was that he wasn't particularly influenced by any of the actual Marx Brothers movies beyond getting the idea from A Night at the Opera, because it seemed to me that the film doesn't do that at all. It does something very different, which is almost kind of show off how it constantly takes ideas from A Night at the Opera and then does something different with them. Yeah. And it got to the point where I actually started making a list of them because there were so many. There's a contract tearing scene, which is totally different from the contract tearing scene. Mm. There's a speech, which is like the aviator speech, but is different. There's a going from room to room scene, which is different from the actual going to room scene. There's a medical examination for, like the one in Races, but is very, very different. Obviously, there's disrupting the show, like in A Night at the Opera. But there are no actual duplicated jokes. And at one point where you see Mel Smith slipping the sheet music in behind the actual sheet music, I thought, okay, right, here at last he's going to actually just take a joke, and why not? It's a great one and it'll work well. But lo and behold, no, that's a different joke too, and an extremely good one. And that was the most impressive thing, I think, for me, was that it was actually constantly riffing on actual bits and pieces, and always did something different, something legitimate, something authentic, and something funny.
And I have to say that they actually did a much better job in an opera of the punch being justified when Volare is kissing her and Alan comes in and he, you know, okay, well, now we know why he's being punched. Okay, none of this, I'm hinting that she's a slut stuff. So good job there.
But if what you're looking for are the classic bits, you know, they're all there. There is an empty your pocket scene. There is a Gookie. There is a Groucho Dumont wooing scene. You know, it's all there, but nothing is pure pastiche.
And there's a crowded room there. You know, it's not the stateroom, but
it's
a variation of it. And I got to tell you guys, I went through that scene and I was looking up all the people in there. And there's a masseuse, and I could not figure out what the name of the actress doing the masseuse is. So I'm going to be looking into that now.
Okay. Yeah, but I think by choosing not to play the actual Marx Brothers and not to impersonate them, it sort of frees up. I mean, it must have been a freer experience to write this screenplay, because instead of the challenge being, what would Harpo Marx do right now? The challenge is just, let's come up with a funny gag.
Yeah, it gave them a real freedom that I don't think an official tribute would have allowed. And, you know, I was looking up the reviews for Brain Donors when it came out, the contemporary reviews, and, you know, they were somewhat good. But one of the more recurring things that amused me was that some complained that it was a little too crass and the jokes were a little too sexually oriented. And I remember thinking, where have I seen that before? And I'm like, oh yeah, the 1932-33 reviews of Monkey Business in Horse Feathers.
Yeah.
They had those same complaints.
It really drives home the point, doesn't it? That although now we think of the Marx Brothers films as great art and classic cinema and a somewhat a cultural product that occupies a high perch, at the time the films came out, they were popular mainstream comedies. You know, they were the equivalent of whatever the top comedies are right now. And, you know, so here it is by the people responsible for a lot of the equivalent top comedies of the 80s and 90s. Mm-hmm. It sort of puts the Marx Brothers in their place in a way that is, you know, that's flattering to them as entertainers. And it does take a little bit of the analytical wind out of our sails.
Yeah, you know, we talked about the title, and you know how I was, at least I did, how I wasn't crazy about the title. I'm also not crazy about this claymation that bookends the film. Not that it isn't well done, I actually think it is, but I don't really think it helps the film or fits in at all.
Yeah.
And it actually hurts at the end, because there's a very good gag at the end of the film, at the end of the live action, And I think right when that live action ends, that would be, that should be the end, slam cut, end of the film. And when you see it, you'll know what I'm talking about. So just my opinion.
I think there probably was a lot of truth in what they were saying about it was padding for time. It is. A comparatively short movie for these times, isn't it? But the other thing I was going to say was, with Pat saying that there was a second screenplay, at least partially written, or certainly a second idea, isn't it an ironic shame that a film this recent, you know, the film that it was only made in the 1990s, you know, cannot be followed up by these players because Mel Smith is no longer with us. Unless you recast again, you know, it can only be an idea. I think he should publish that script, though. He should release it as a book.
But you know, if he had come up with any really good jokes there, I'm sure he would have used them in subsequent projects. So they're not just sitting there in a drawer.
Yeah.
And I wanted to bring up one other thing. Did anyone else notice that the guy who played the hero dancer? Did anyone else notice that it seemed like all of his dialogue in the film was dubbed?
He does feel a little dubbed, yeah. And some of his early scenes, I had the impression that maybe he was putting on an American accent. Maybe he wasn't really an English speaker, or maybe he...
His name is...
Spike Alexander.
It seemed like all his dialogue was dubbed in. Maybe that's not his original voice. Maybe that's why they thought of him as the Zeppo, because he's not that good an actor. No, I don't know. Spike, if you're listening, you did a great job.
Juliana Donald, who's billed as Julie Donald, who plays the ingenue role, I knew she was familiar to me from something. I couldn't put it together. She played the character of Jenny in The Muppets Take Manhattan.
Oh, and I should also say, for any British listeners, if you still need to have this sold to you and Mel Smith isn't quite enough, John Savidant appears in it in the equivalent role to Sig Ruman, Laszlo, the pompous lawyer. John Savidant was an actor who'd appeared in many things, including Clockwork Orange and lots of stuff like that. But he's most famous for having a regular role in Coronation Street, which is not a sitcom, if only it was a sitcom, a soap opera that's been on forever here since the early 1960s. He was a regular on that. And he was also in the news back in 2000 because he was stabbed in his neck during the night in his own house.
Mm. Wait a minute. I thought that was George Harrison.
Very much like that, yeah. Yeah. And he played a butcher in Coronation Street, and the large plaster that he had on his neck afterwards was explained in the plot of Coronation Street as an accident he'd had in his butcher's shop. But anyway, he's in the film, and he's very funny.
And believe it or not, according to the internet, he's still around.
Oh, is he? Yeah. Let's get him on.
Our friend Dan Ward on Twitter pointed out that in the empty your pockets gag, a pair of Groucho glasses are among the things that Bob Nelson takes out of his coat. And there's also a little bit of comedy with the harp in the orchestra pit at the ballet.
So it looms up in the foreground, doesn't it, in a very suggestive way. Yeah.
Yeah. And he uses it to slice a pound cake or something.
Yeah, yeah.
In jail, they all start singing. They sing a little medley of songs together. That feels very much like, we got to do the Marx Brothers thing where they spontaneously erupt into song. They sing The Lion Sleeps Tonight and Nobody Knows the Troubles I've Seen.
Yeah, again, a very good joke. And it starts off with them singing very mournfully. And in the end, they're just singing for the hell of it. So, again, a very authentic joke.
And Matthew, I want to thank you for saying something that I didn't have the nerve to say. That this might actually be better or funnier than a couple of actual Marx Brothers films. Now
that did slip out, didn't it? Yeah.
I know this is going to lose us a few subscribers. Maybe Scott Alexander. I don't know, but it had to be said.
Yeah, as I said, you know, I just wish some of those later scripts had anything like that kind of ratio of joke to straight line. You know,
or at least approach. Yeah.
If the later Marx Brothers vehicles had been created with the same kind of reverence for the early Marx Brothers vehicles that this film was.
Yeah.
That's the thing, isn't it? It was made by people who love the Marx Brothers, and unfortunately, those last MGM films are not made by people who love the Marx Brothers.
You don't think Irving Berker loved the Marx Brothers?
Well,
I'm just kidding.
Brecker was hell bent on destroying the Marx Brothers. We all know this. What do you guys think about the rest of the Zucker and Abrams and Proft filmography and its connection to the Marx Brothers? I mean, they are in many ways the exponent of broad film comedy in their era.
I liked what I think David said, that Airplane was their Night at the Opera and Top Secret was their Duck Soup.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, I had the great experience of seeing Top Secret for the first time just a few days ago. Most of the ZAZ films I saw when I was a kid, but somehow I missed that one. So I got to see it for the first time and loved it. I really liked it a lot. Mm. And I know it's interesting. David, in his conversation with us and also in other interviews that I've read, has talked about it as being, I guess, in his mind, something of a misfire because of the lack of a specific satirical target, that it's kind of a World War II movie, it's kind of an Elvis movie, it combines all these. But maybe that was a bigger problem when it was new. Now it seems like this kind of joyous mashup of cinematic mm-hmm. tropes and a pretty impressive act of sustained cinematic laugh-out-loud stuff.
Mm-hmm.
As often with these films, the momentum builds over the course of the film, and so when you may just be kind of cracking a smile at the gags in the first stretch of the film, if it's working, by the time you get to the third act, you're just helpless. And so in Top Secret, by the time we got to the singing horse, it was all over for me.
Yeah.
I couldn't sit up straight anymore.
And then with that Wizard of Oz ending, I mean, I just wanted to stand and cheer.
Yeah.
I'm missing most of all Scarecrow, you know.
Yes. Yes, and that film in a big way, but also Airplane and Naked Gun films and you know, a very common device is that the characters in these films often find themselves sort of dropped unexpectedly into familiar scenes and bits of dialogue from classic films. You know, these extended references are all of a sudden we're in Casablanca or something. Mm-hmm. And in a way, Brain Donors is an extended version of that gag. It's just a Marx Brothers film. These characters have found themselves in Marx Brothers land. The same way in Top Secret, suddenly we're having the same conversation Bogart and Bergman did in Casablanca. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's going to about do it. You know, there's nothing that will ruin a good comedy more than overanalyzing it. So I think we should maybe just get out of here and let everybody just find the film legally and enjoy it. And for those of you who are upset, we did mention the Marx Brothers a few times during this episode. So this does qualify as an official episode of the podcast. Okay. Now for our final song, I've picked something that's related to the episode that we just heard and has personal meaning to me. And for those of you who have seen my wife park a vehicle, I think you'll understand the tie-in. So let's hear it.
Brothers Council Podcast is hosted by Matthew Conium, Noah Diamond, and Bob Gassell, and is produced and edited by Bob Gassell. Matthew Conium's books, The Annotated Marx Brothers and That's Me, Groucho, are published by McFarland. Noah Diamond's book, Give Me a Thrill, The Story of All Say She Is, is published by Bear Manor Media. Both can be found at major book outlets. For more info on this and all episodes, visit our website at MarxBrothersCouncilPodcast.com. Also look for us on Twitter, but not on Parler. And for the place to talk Marx and meet fellow fans, join us on the lively Marx Brothers Council Facebook group. This is Heidi Gassell, and I suck at parking. See you next time!
Surely you can't be serious.
I am serious, and don't call me Shirley.